morning. Hope you are fine and safe. Today we'll see trigger in Oracle. What is a trigger? The definition goes somewhat like this. A trigger is a named PLSQL block stored in the Oracle database and executed automatically when a triggering event takes place. So we are familiar with the concept of integrity. We have integrity constraint. Whenever you are creating a table, we can have some integrity constraints that will check or that will enforce the correctness of the data that we are going to store in the database. So like as in the case of create table, if you are specifying a particular field as a primary key, then we can ensure that there will not be any duplication for that particular field. That is, if we have specified roll number as the primary key, then we will not be having any duplication for the roll number field. So that is about integrity constraint. And we have other constraints like not null constraint is there. Then we are having the unique constraint. Foreign key constraint is there, then default constraint, check constraint. Likewise, we are having a set of constraints that will enforce the integrity of the data in the database. But still, there are some business rules that cannot be enforced using our traditional integrity constraints. So in such cases, we'll be making use of triggers. Now, a trigger is a named PLSQL block. It's a special type of PLSQL block stored in the Oracle database and executed automatically when a triggering event takes place. That is, whenever some specific actions occur in the database, the trigger will get executed. So what are the events that can be controlled by the user? And we will see what should happen when that particular event happened. Okay. Then the events can be, it can be a DML statement like insert, update, or delete. So if an insert statement happens in our database, what should be done? What are the things that should happen automatically? We can specify that. We can have a DL statement like create or alter. In such cases, these DDL statements are mainly used for auditing purposes, like the record, that is to record the changes happening to the schema of the database. If there is some changes to the schema, that will can be audited, that can be kept as a record using the triggers. Then we can monitor some system events like shutdown or startup, and login and logout. That is, the user events like login or logout also can be monitored using the triggers. That is, whenever logout happens, is there any specific things that should happen in our database system that can be specified using the triggers? So the act of executing a trigger is called firing a trigger. We will get that. We will say that a trigger get fired when that event happened. Now uses of triggers, usage or uses of triggers. As I have told you, these triggers are mainly used for enforcing complex business rules that cannot be implemented using the traditional integrity constraints. Then for preventing some invalid transactions that will hamper the integrity of the system or the database system, then we can make use of the triggers. That is to prevent something from happening. Another thing is to gather statistical information on table access, how many times or how often a particular table has been accessed by some users. For such things also, we can make use of triggers. Then to generate some values automatically from the derived columns. Then auditing sensitive data. Sometimes we may need to monitor some data that is very crucial. So for such cases also, we can make use of the triggers. So we'll see now what are the parts of a trigger, how to create a trigger, what are the different parts of a trigger. First and the important thing is a triggering event. Triggering event in the sense, when the trigger should get fired, when should it, when should it get executed. So triggering event, then trigger restriction. For every operation, there should be some limiting condition, and in this case, we can have some restriction for the triggers, and that can be specified using the trigger restriction part. And the action, what should be done when that triggering event happened? When that triggering event happened, what should be done? That is the triggering action, trigger action. So we are having three different parts for the trigger. What is one is the triggering event, trigger restriction, and the third one is trigger action. So we'll see the syntax of the trigger very quickly. It is, as we are familiar with the procedures, that is somewhat similar to that. Actually, we know that trigger is a PLSQL, special type of PLSQL block. Here also, the first statement is create or replace trigger, trigger name. I think it's quite obvious. Create, that is we are going to create the trigger, or replace, that is optional. And here in most cases we'll be making use of that replace option also. So here create or replace trigger, trigger name. Trigger name is any valid name. Trigger is the keyword to create the trigger. So we'll be creating the trigger using this create or replace. That is, if we have created the trigger and we want to modify the existing trigger, we will be making use of create or replace. Even though we have specified it as an optional part, in most cases we will be making it. That is, we'll be using that. That is create or replace. Then what? Before or after triggering event on table name. Here we'll have to specify some things. That is, we'll have to specify the table on which the trigger should happen. That is, the concerned table should be specified. Then we'll have to specify the triggering event, like it can be a DML statement like insert, update or delete, or some DDL statement like create, shutdown, that logout, something. That is, we'll have to specify the triggering event here. Then that is, the first thing is before or after. We'll have to specify this triggering event should happen before the DML operation or after the DML operation. For each row in the sense here, that should be noted. For each row means we are specifying that the trigger is a row level trigger. That is, this trigger will get fired for each and every row. We are having another option, like we are having a statement level trigger. Statement triggers will not be having this for each row clause. So this will be omitted. We are having two different types of triggers. One is the row level trigger, and the other one is the statement trigger. Statement trigger will not be having this for each row clause. Follows or precedes another trigger. That is optional thing. That is, if we are having already we are having a trigger, and if you want to specify whether our trigger should precede it, or that should happen before that or after that, that can be specified using the follows or precedes clause. That is optional. Enable or disable. By default, the trigger will be enabled, and if we want, we can disable the trigger. That is, in some special cases we may not want this trigger to happen. So in such cases we can use the disable option. So you should note that the enable is the default option, and we need not have to specify the enable. If we are using the enable, it's a default thing, and we need not have to specify that explicitly. Then when condition is when this particular thing should happen. That is we are having the restriction here. Then we are having the body of the trigger. What are the things that should happen in the what are the things that should happen after the trigger event has fired? All those things will be there. Now we'll see the execution of a trigger. Okay. Likewise, we are going to create a trigger. We'll use uppercases. Select star. actually this is, I am doing this always because just to make sure that the thing is there. Okay, we are having the table, previous table, EID, Alex, Manager, 6000, all those things, they are there. Now we'll create the trigger. What is the syntax? Create or replace. What is the purpose? Okay, I will see. Our trigger will be, suppose I am modifying the value truck code in this particular table. Now, I am going to modify, we are having the integer value in salary, no? Okay, we'll modify the salary and we'll list out the salary difference. Suppose I am modifying, we are updating the salary. So we'll specify how much it has changed. So that is our trigger. That is what we are going to do. Create or replace. Trigger name. We'll specify some trigger. Okay, display difference. We'll specify it as disp difference. This difference before insert or update. Okay, for these two operations we can specify this trigger should get fired on which table? On our table, one and only one table, employee. That should happen for each row. That is, we are creating a row level trigger for each row. We are creating a row level trigger, and you'll have to specify some condition. I am specifying the condition as when our bind variable new, the new value of salary, we are going to modify salary. When new salary is greater than or equal to zero, that's a limiting condition. That is, this will get fired for all the cases. Now, whenever we are making some operation, then salary will be there and it will automatically, it will be greater than zero. So it will happen for all the cases. So this is our trigger, create or replace trigger, this diff before insert or update on employee for each row. New cell is greater than or equal to zero. Then we will, heading is okay. Then heading. Then declare what? Okay, we'll see cell diff as the variable that you hold the difference in salaries. Salary, both in new salary and the previous salary. Then begin. So we'll calculate sal diff, our variable sal diff is equal to, what is that? We'll use the bind variables, new salary minus old salary, that is old dot salary. That means we are specifying the salary, new salary as new salary, and old salary, that is the previous salary. In the first case, which will not be having, if you are performing insertion operation, we will not be having any value there. Okay, then we'll print that PPMS out dot put line what? First, we'll specify the old salary, will display the old salary and the new salary. That is just for a confirmation. What is that? Old salary will be in bind variable old dot salary. It's a bind variable. That is, we'll have to specify. We are using it to get the previous salary. Then what? PPMS output dot put line what new salary also will be printed. New salary. Please give some space here. This is decluttered. Okay. New. We are using the bind variable. New salary. Okay. Old salary is printed. Old salary, new salary, both are printed. Then we'll specify the, we'll print the difference in salary. That is being recorded in the salary variable. DPMS output dot put line. What specific difference is what sal underscore diff. End. So we'll try to run this. Invalid trigger type. Create or replace trigger. Create or replace trigger. Disp diff before insert or update. Update on employee. Okay, we'll try to run that once again. Now here we are having missing some semicolon, I think. Create or replace before greater than or equal to 0. Declare sal diff equal to none. Here it's an assigned operation, no? So we'll have to specify that colon also. Okay, here we have created our trigger, and this is okay. We are having this trigger right now in the in our database. Now we'll list the employee table once again. So here we will try to update the value of Alex, or we'll insert some value, insert a new value, insert into employee values. We'll give the value set. We'll give some E123 is the employee ID. Then we'll give it ASDF as the employee name. Then QWERT as the designation. And we'll give 12,000 as our salary. Then D name is ZXCV. Okay, we are giving some D name as 23. Summary. So we are going to insert a new record into our table. And what should happen then? We have created our trigger for insert. That will, our trigger is there. This how we have created the trigger, and that is existing in the database. So whenever there is an insert operation or update operation, the trigger will be executed, and that will give output as accordingly. So we'll try to do that. Okay, old salary. Old salary, we are not having an old salary. The new salary is 12,000, difference is 0. Actually, we are not having any value there. That is it. We'll try to update some already existing value. So actually, if whenever we are having the insert statement or update statement, this trigger will be automatically executed. We'll update some value record here. Update. Update. Employee set salary equal to 20,000. 20,000. Okay, 20,000. Before that, I will run this one. Okay, we are having 60,000 for Alex, so we'll modify his salary. Salary is equal to, we'll give him 80,000 salary. 8,000. Update salary, set salary to 8,000. Where EID equal to what is Alex EAD? E001. So that's it. We'll try to run this one. No need for this parenthesis here. Okay, what we have done? We are updating the salary for E00, that is Alex. Now his present salary is 60,000. So here, if we are executing this one, our trigger is there and that should get fired. Okay, satisfied. Old salary is 60,000, new salary is 80,000, difference is 20,000. Let's repeat. Salary difference is 20,000. That is, whenever we are having some operation here, this particular, whenever we are having some DML operation, this is our trigger. Actually, it is based on this insert and update, and whenever we are having a DML statement like this, our trigger will get fired and that will give you the output. So that's it. So creator, that is a trigger syntax. We have created the trigger, create or replace before or after for each row, that is for row level trigger. Follows if you are having a, already having a trigger, we can have precedes or follows. Then enable or disable when condition. We saw some of the optional parts were skipped in our real exam. Then the declaration part and the statement. So that's it. Hope you understood the thing. Thank you.